Augen, das Rumpen der Wange, den Rumpf in die Herde. Hey, hey, hey.
night as I woke me up about 3:15 in the morning and caused me to go through the house praying. But I woke up with a headache and I did take an ibuprofen. Problem is the headache doesn't want to go anywhere. But the devil's a liar, I'm going to preach today.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you touch me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, Lord God. Oh Lord, I just ask that you just have your way with me. Let me decrease and you increase. And that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, a few weeks back, the Lord gave me a message. And I don't know if Bishop remembers, but he sent me a text message. It took me a while to respond. And I had to say, I'm sorry, I'm working on my message. But the title of my message today is Keep It Moving. And I'm coming from Philippians 3, verses 12 through 14. Not that I have already obtained all of this, and this is a testimony, y'all, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do. Forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus Christ. Now I'm going to give y'all a warning. Buckle up, buttercup.
All right.
I'm getting ready to blow your mind. And once I get started, y'all gonna understand why. We have a season that most men love and most women dread upon us. And anyone knows me knows I don't care about football. So I had to do a little research. I had to ask some questions, do some refreshing. Yeah, there was a time that I used to watch football. My son played. I had to go to all of the games and all of that. But then after a while, you just don't care anymore. You know what I mean? So I'm going to give a brief summary on this and of this particular game. And it's not new to some. I'm looking at some people, looking over people's heads, waiting to see where she's going with this. You may already be aware of the basics of football, but there may be one or two that don't know. So if you could just bear with me a minute while I give a summary. We start with a 100-yard field, okay, with a painted stripe that goes across from one side to the other every 5 yards. Between those stripes are short lines called hash marks. They're every 1 yard. Every 10 yards, there's a number, okay? Now, at the beginning of the game, you have 22 men on the field. At the 50-yard line, 11 on one side is wearing a helmet that has a dolphin on it. And 11 on the other side that has a helmet that has a purple bird on it. And yes, I know the Dolphins played the Ravens and beat them. I know that. I did catch that much. Okay? But the object is that the offensive team, and for those of us that don't know what the offensive team is, that's the team that has the ball, gets 4 yards, four downs, or opportunities to move this ball ahead 10 yards.
Yes, yes, come on.
Okay?
Record.
Right. Now, if you get that ball 10 yards ahead without any fumbles or tackles, or sacks, you get another 4 opportunities. Okay? The goal is to get this ball down 50 yards into the end zone and get what they call a touchdown. If you don't get that 10 yards, you got to give up the ball. But the one thing I noticed about these teams is they don't just give up. Everybody seen the movie Radio when he gives the ball to the guy and he says, here's your ball. They punt that bad boy so that the opposing team has farther to go to get to their goal. Now, in the cases when there's a problem and they either fumble and it is recovered by the other team or the quarterback is sacked in the backfield, the team does not do something that a lot of us do. They don't walk off the field, go to the locker room, change their clothes, and go home. They can't win the game that way. They have to push. Now, for us, that's pray until something happens. And they have to push. They're trying to get from where they got knocked back, whether it be a 5-yard penalty or the sack, from that point back to where they started, so they continue to move ahead. That's unfortunate that we don't see ourselves as teenagers, as a football team. A lot of times we as Christians, and I'm going to use that term right now, when God doesn't answer our prayer the first time, we want to give up. We want to go home. We don't keep it moving. And I say we because I don't like to say you, because it makes people feel like you're beating up on them. We all do it. Do you think that that team, if they did that, would be run close to getting a championship ring?
No.
No, they wouldn't. Their goal may be 10 yards. Their goal may be a touchdown. Their goal may be a field goal. They're working towards something.
Yes, they are.
And just because they get a tackle or run out of bounds or whatever the case may be, they keep it moving. They keep it going. Because they have their mind made up to get to the other side, to get the prize, to get the game, to get they want the stats. 10-0 and 10 is not going to work for them. Why not us? I was talking to the Lord about some things. And I'm going to tell you something. Even last night, he had a talk with me. And he said, you think you're the only person that didn't get their prayer answered the first time you prayed?
I
did. Let me remind you, you know your playbook. Because, you know, as the football player team, they have playbooks. When they go on the field, they know their position. They're focused on their position. They play their position. If they don't know the playbook, they're going to be lost. I want to remind you of Elijah, who was praying for rain. And he sent his servant out 7 times looking for rain. Now, I know by 7 times, The servant was like, little dude, I done been out there 6 times. Ain't nothing happening. Why don't you get up off your rump and go get check it yourself? But the 7th time he came back with a report. 7 times. Mm-hmm. I see the cloud the size of the smallest cloud the size of a man's hand. 7 times. Uh-huh. And you crying because your prayer ain't been answered on the first go around? Let me remind you of another one. What was his name? The guy with the thorn in his side? Mm-hmm. Paul? Mm-hmm. 3 times he pleaded with God to remove the thorn. And the answer that he got was not something I'm sure he was looking forward to. The answer he got was, my grace is sufficient.
Yes, Lord.
He wanted the thorn gone. We're not going to get everything that we want or pray for. Some things just aren't for us. They'd be more harmful than helpful. So we just need to put on our big boy and big girl pants and deal with it.
Except the will of God. Come on.
I'm not talking to anybody in here because, see, I know everybody in here is understanding of that. But there might be somebody somewhere that listens to this later on. Maybe you got it on demand and you're going through something and you don't understand why God's not answering your prayer right here, right now. First of all, he don't move on our timeline. His time and our time are 2 different zones. It's like trying to put your alarm clock on California time. You're going to wake up 3 hours too early or late, so. But there are some other things, not just this football thing. Because when I was thinking about what their goals were and what the difference between the football team's goals and the difference between our goals, and I was like, okay, well, you know, we may not be going for that 10 yards or the touchdown or I don't care. So even though I did the research, I'm going to mess it up. But I'm all right with that. I'm okay with that. I'm going to keep it moving.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
My goal is to work out my own soul salvation.
Oh, it's been me. Come on.
My goal is to build the kingdom of God. My goal is to be a resident in the New Jerusalem in a mansion not made by man's hands.
Yes, sir.
And just like that football team is not going to get that championship ring if they pick it back up and go home because they didn't get their way, or there was an obstacle, or there was a fumble, or a tackle, I have to keep it moving.
Yes, Lord.
Those things are going to happen. If I can't go straight up center field, I might have to shift and go down the sideline.
Yeah.
But I have to keep it moving.
Yeah.
I can't get stuck. I can't turn and go back. And I know we've all seen those football games with the little league players and the little boy gets the ball and he is so excited about having the ball. He's running this little hard out, the team's running down the sideboard. You're going the wrong way. I'm not going to reach my goal going the wrong way.
Come on. Dr. Press.
That's why in Hebrews, when we put on the full armor of God, it talks about a breastplate and a shield and a sword. It don't say nothing about that back plate. Mm-hmm. You running down the field the wrong way, your back is open for attack. You have to keep it moving in the direction that is assigned to your team. You may not have an 11-man team, but you got a team that is so powerful. You've got the Father. You've got the Son. You've got the Holy Ghost, and you got you.
Yes.
Come on.
Amen.
You can't lose with a team.
Can't lose.
want to attack you. Keep it moving.
Keep it moving.
Keep it moving. Don't stop. Don't stop. Don't stop. You know, I want you to, I'm sure Bishop and Pastor Harris can attest to the fact that there have been times over the years where I said, you know what, I'm done. I'm done. I've had enough. I'm done. Everybody gets to that point.
Yes, they, yes, we do. Yes, we do.
Just because we stand here does not mean that we are not subjected to hurts and disappointments and frustrations. But what we do know is that there are souls that we've been called to reach. And if we don't keep it moving, those souls could be lost.
Could be lost. Could be lost. So true.
Every time I feel like throwing in the towel,
I keep it moving.
I hear Jesus saying, any man that puts his hand to the plow and turns from it is not fit for the kingdom of God.
Not fit for the kingdom. Come on. Come on, stay there, stay there.
And even though I'm here, I have to pull back.
Yes, yes, yes.
I can't allow myself to be lost. Because my goal is to live and make it to the New Jerusalem. There's a scripture in Proverbs. Well, it's actually in, it's in Proverbs, but 2 Peter speaks of it. He says, a dog returns to his vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to her wobbling in the mud. Anybody know what that means? We turn right back to the thing that we've been delivered from.
My goodness.
When we don't get our way, spoiled brats.
My goodness.
We have to, once we have accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have to keep it moving. We have to go from, well, don't look nowhere, honey. I need you for a minute. We have to keep it moving. I'm gonna move to that, Father. Imagine him about 50 years ago. Come here, baby. Yeah, you baby right now because I need you.
He always baby. Come on, baby.
You always baby.
Yeah. So, he always baby.
I'm going to put baby in the corner.
Now, about 50 years ago, this man ran track. That was before he was old, broke down, and mine. I'm claiming he, yes, he's old, broke down. I ain't gonna lie about it.
But he's yours.
But he's mine. When he came to the track field, I'm changing sports for a minute. Don't think I've been wrong. I don't hope not to lose y'all. But when he came to the track field, he came with everything that he needed to win a race. He believed he could do it. He had the physicality to do it. He had the speed to do it. But I want to show y'all something. And this might bring it home to y'all. I need you to get in starting position. On your mark, get set.
Okay, he still got him. He still got him.
Y'all gonna have to help him up.
He still got him.
Go. Exactly. How you gonna win a race if you don't get off the blocks? How are you gonna make it to the New Jerusalem if you're still in the start? important position.
Mm-hmm. All right.
If you still...
Come on.
You have to make up in your mind that for God I live, for God I die. Doesn't matter what I'm going through. Wife acting up, husband acting up, kids acting up, job just fired me, landlord's crying for the rent which I should have paid during the pandemic, but I decided I wanted to take that. What was that they gave the landlords when they didn't have to, people didn't have to pay rent? That moratorium, they should have been paying it anyway, especially if they could, because they knew the man was going to come for his rent.
You talking good?
All right. We have to keep it moving.
Oh, you talking good today?
We have to stay Kim. K-I-M. If you don't remember nothing else, remember those three letters. K-I-M. When you don't feel like going, K-I-M. I'm telling you, if I tell you about the dream I had last night, or the headache I woke up with, the devil is a liar. I'm going to keep it moving.
Yes.
Because today's going to come when I'm going to have to answer for what I didn't do.
Yes.
It's coming. I look ahead and depict, you know, I was on Facebook and on my birthday, and I said, I had a picture of me and I was stepping, and I put on there, today I walk into 64, and his brother says down in Texas says, I don't believe the age that you're telling me, but happy birthday. I got less years ahead of me than I do behind me.
Come on, come on.
Go ahead.
No one knows the day or the hour. I could walk out of here today and walk in front of a bus and that be it. If I don't do what God has called me to do while I can do it, judgment day is going to come for me.
Come on,
like everybody else, and I'm going to have to answer for it.
Come on, now.
I think I've said about enough. Because somebody somewhere is mad. That dream last night.
It's all good.
But there's one more thing that I wanted to share with you guys. You all know I ain't crazy about Facebook. If it wasn't for our lessons and our Bible studies and all of that, I'd shut that damn story down quicker. Because frankly, I don't care how much Gucci you got. She works fine for me. So does Shoe Dazzle and
Just
Bang. I had somebody on the red pack that had me hooked the rainbow shots at one point. I had to break up with them. I can't do this no more. But mainly because I was finding stuff for them and nothing for me. For some reason, the plus sizes look so much better than some of the stuff they had in my size. Because I can't come to church with everything hanging out. I can hear people now. Y'all see what Pastor Judy had? It was cut down to here and up to there, and she thinks she's going to be leading somebody to Christ. Well, I might. Somebody might need to see that even us church folks still got a little something going on. But anyway, I was scrolling on Facebook one day, and I'll see if I can enlarge this a little bit. And I saw this thing, and I was like, I pray that the author of it does not get upset for me borrowing this little post. But it says, three things to remember to help you move forward. The life in front of you is more important than the life behind you.
Yes, yes, yes.
I don't know how many of y'all have some hell behind you.
My goodness.
But it ain't nothing I want to go back to.
My goodness.
I want to look forward to the glory
yes.
that is in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Ask yourself if what you're doing today is getting you closer to where you want to be tomorrow.
My goodness. All right. All right.
That's it.
And thirdly, don't be a prisoner of your past. It was just a lesson, not a life sentence.
Yes.
So with that being said, I encourage you, whether you're in this sanctuary with me today, where you can hear my voice and see my face, or whether you're on Facebook, or you look at it later, to ask yourself those three questions. And if it's not getting you to where you need to be in Christ. Because, you know, one thing I say to my sons is, I want you to have a successful life. Now, it's not success as it relates to wealth and riches. It's success as in whether you're happy in what you're doing. Whether you're blessing someone. Whether you're helping someone. That's success. A mansion on the hill ain't gonna get you to heaven.
Come on.
As a matter of fact, when I need some funds, I pray to my father the cattle on 1,000 hills belong to you. I need you to sell a couple of them and send me a paycheck, a check. Because, Lord, I need some help.
Yes,
Lord.
Amen. Do I have the right to ask him that? Yes, because I am his daughter.
Come on now. Come on now.
A little off track, but I just, it had to come out.
Yes, yes.
That was a download that just had to be released. But more importantly, whatever you do, once you give your life to Christ, don't stop. Don't let nobody block you from reaching your goal. Make up in your mind that you're going to keep it moving. Because Christ is soon to come. People are dying. They have no business dying.
All right.
They're minding their business. Folks are so lost, they don't know the difference between mine and thine. And they will kill you for what you have.
Yes,
keep it moving. I'm done.
Let's encourage Pastor Judy. Let us put our hands together and thank God again for the word of encouragement, instruction, and inspiration. And no matter what we are doing in life, no matter what our present place is in life, that we are to KIM. I'm going to ask if we can all stretch our hands forward. Amen. As we cover her. Amen. She does all in Barry. Amen. Lay his hands with me. Amen. Just to encourage her. Amen. For the words. Amen. Keep it moving as you have declared. Amen. We release the word back over you on today. Amen. We cover you. We plead the blood, amen, of Yeshua over your life, that he keeps you in his keeping power, your household, your husband, your children, your grandchild, everyone that he has placed, amen, under the care of your home. We pray that they be covered, that your ministry be covered, amen, that your life be covered. We pray for peace, for protection, for joy, for prosperity, that every need be met. That, amen, the eternal continues to do exceeding and abundantly in your life above all you may ask or think according to the power that worketh within you. We thank God for your ministry. We thank him for the anointing on your life. We thank him for the grace on your life. We pray that you will continue to be your servant's daughter and will continue to do your Father's will. And as you continue to do your Father's will and abide in his will, that he will fulfill his word within you and withhold no good thing from you as you continue to walk upright in him. We thank you, Father. We thank you in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. In Yahshua's name, we praise you. And we thank you, God. We do say amen and amen. Amen. Even